Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bouton, The Life of a Baseball Original by Mitchell Nathanson, narrated by Barry Abrams. With rebellion, awareness is born. Albert Camus. Prologue. Publication Day. The banging on the door was not going to stop. That was clear enough from both its frequency and its force. Norm Miller sat naked on the bed as the cacophony engulfed him. On one side of the room, the persistent ringing of the telephone. On the other, the banging of the door. His roommate was taking care of the telephone, for the moment at least, engaging the reporter on the other end of the line. Miller had lost count by now of the number of calls his roommate had received already. As soon as he nestled the receiver into its cradle, off it would go again within seconds. Never before had the arrival of the perennial sad sack Houston Astros to New York generated this much attention, but never before had anybody on the club or in the game of baseball drawn attention to themselves or the game in the way Jim Bouton just had. Bouton tried his best to talk over the pounding on the door, but the louder he spoke, the more persistent it became. Finally, he pleadingly eyed Miller, and Miller realized that he had no choice but to answer the door. He rose from the bed and, in his full glory, opened it to behold a scowling Howard Cosell, swathed in his rumpled trench coat and fedora. No matter what the weather, no matter what the circumstance, Cosell always looked as if he were in an early stage of melt. The morning's glorious late spring sunshine had no bearing on his visage in the least. Cosell looked right through Miller and lasered in on his target. Not waiting for an invitation from the naked utility outfielder, Cosell brushed by him and headed straight for the phone, grabbing it out of Bouton's hand. He sneered his nasal twang into the mouthpiece, cutting off in his staccato cadence the voice on the other end of the line in mid-sentence, "This interview is terminated," and slammed the receiver down. Now, for the moment at least, there was silence. No ringing of the phone, no knocking on the door. Miller returned to his bed and considered pulling up the covers. Instead, he slowly stretched out to listen. No matter, he could have lit himself on fire and Cosell would not have looked away from Bouton. Because Cosell was where every sports writer, sportscaster, and baseball fan wanted to be, standing face to face with the man who had just blown up the national pastime. The June 2, 1970 edition of Look magazine had hit the stands just hours earlier, and in it was a 10-page excerpt of Ball 4. In those 10 pages, a century of baseball mythology was set aflame and vaporized. Therein, readers were assaulted with tales of greenies, carousing, beaver shooting, and players making out, with stewardesses, groupies, and, after a few drinks, each other. But most scandalous of all was a portrayal of baseball's golden boy, Mickey Mantle, drunkenly staggering into the batter's box and somehow hitting a home run. What's more, another bomb was promised in the next issue, 2 weeks hence. The book hadn't even reached bookstores yet, and already everybody wanted to speak with the journeyman pitcher who had written it. Much of America was, by 1970, coming apart at the seams. Only baseball seemed stitched tightly enough to resist the forces of change, wound as it was deep into its mythic past. Or so it had appeared. When the June 2nd edition of Look hit the stands, myth became exposed as such, and baseball, for the first time, looked very much like the real world in which it was played. Cosell might have been oblivious to a lot of what was happening in Miller and Bouton's Roosevelt Hotel room that Friday morning, but he was keenly aware of one thing, that he was bearing witness to the dawn of a new era. Baseball had spent more than a century building itself up as something otherworldly. With the release of Ball 4, Jim Bouton brought it down to earth. Cosell, who liked to brag that only he could tell it like it is, was at last staring down a man who really did. If it appeared odd that it was a Major League Baseball player, of all people, who had unmasked the cloistered world of the professional athlete, it made perfect sense that Jim Bouton would be the MLB player to do it. Already, at age 31, it was a role he seemed destined to play his entire life. Part 1. The Bulldog. 1. Warm-up Bouton. On the day Jim Bouton was born, Generalissimo Francisco Franco declared a total blockade of all Republican-controlled ports in Spain, threatening to torpedo any and all ships that entered what he now declared his waters. A day earlier, Mahatma Gandhi ended a 4-day fast over the issue of constitutional reform in Rajkot, and a day before that, back in the States, the United Automobile Workers amended its constitution to officially bar communists from its ranks. Jim Bouton may have been born into the weight of history when he arrived on March 8, 1939, but to his good fortune, he had likewise been born into a family that was hardly imprisoned by it. It could very well have been. The Boutons can trace their roots back to 16th century France, where Nicholas Bouton was better known as Count Chamis, Baron Montague de Naton, and his son not only claimed a title himself, but a spot on the portrait wall in the Gallery of French Nobles at Versailles. More recently, Daniel Bouton was bayoneted by a British infantryman at the Battle of Bunker Hill in 1775, becoming the first, but certainly not the last, Bouton the establishment desired to see filleted. But it wasn't their history that defined the Boutons. Instead, it was their desire to upend and redirect it. On both sides, Jim Bouton's lineage was dotted with tinkerers, with fiddlers, with people who saw things as they might be, rather than merely as they were. Both grandfathers were inventors of a sort. His maternal grandfather patented several variations on the pressure cooker. His company was later bought out by the pressure-frying behemoth Hobart, and his paternal grandfather obtained patents while at Westinghouse on an elevator system for efficiently ferrying fighter planes from the underdeck of aircraft carriers to the flight deck. If his family had one defining characteristic, his brother Bob recalled, it was in making it up, things and otherwise. Both families resided in prim, proper Park Ridge, Illinois. The Rodhams lived nearby. Hillary would not arrive until 1947, where Jim's parents met and eventually became a couple. They weren't yet married when Jim's mother Trudy became unexpectedly pregnant with him in 1938. Once word got around, the moral arbiters of the neighborhood made it clear that that would not do in Park Ridge. They were encouraged to seek residence elsewhere for the duration of the pregnancy. Left with little choice, Jim's parents withdrew from high school and went to live with a grandparent in the more socially tolerant New York City area. For Jim's father, George, a swimming, diving, and track star at Park Ridge's main township high school, this meant the abandonment of his formal education. He turned down athletic scholarship offers from Duke and Brown as he headed east to look for work to support the new family he suddenly had responsibility for. After a time, the Boutons settled in Rochelle Park, New Jersey, where during the war, George had spent time in the Navy. Without a college degree, his options were limited. Eventually, his father-in-law got him a job with his company selling pressure cookers. Soon, he began taking night classes in an effort to regain some of what he had lost earlier. "When I was real young," Jim recalled years later, "Dad sold pressure cookers in a department store all day, went to Columbia University at night, and still had time to do things like build an addition on the house." Jim's brother Pete recalled a man who rarely came home unrumpled. "He had his feet in both worlds, blue collar and white," he remembered. "He was smart and industrious, but lacking the credentials that would firmly place him in a position of safety from market forces. Whatever job he had, it was the one that they got rid of whenever times got tough," said Pete. Regardless, for much of Jim's youth, the Boutons were a traditional one-income family. Trudy was a stay-at-home mother, tending to the expanding Rochelle Park house along with Jim and his brother Bob, who came along nearly 2 years later. She joined the neighborhood bridge club, organized get-togethers with neighbors, and lived a life on the proverbial mid-century suburban front porch. For a time, she was a gray lady volunteer at a local hospital. The Bouton boys, Jim, Bob, and a few years later baby brother Pete, were, like many boys of the era, on their own for most of the day. "Moms at the time," Pete recalled, "weren't too involved with boys. They'd get kicked out of the house in the morning and wouldn't come home until the streetlights came on. We'd be out playing all day long, and Mom would call us in for lunch or dinner, but that was about it. We'd do our own thing, go down to the playground or into town or wherever. She had no idea where the hell we were." Wherever they were rarely bored. Traversing the environs of Rochelle Park wasn't difficult. There wasn't much of Rochelle Park to traverse. Located in southwest Bergen County, it was, Jim remembered, more of a cartographic afterthought than anything. "On local maps, it appears as a dot west of Hackensack. On larger maps, it doesn't even have its own dot." All three Bouton boys shared a bedroom in their home on Central Avenue, one they couldn't wait to escape as soon as the sun rose. Because they were closer in age, Jim and Bob would often pal around together, stopping at Slupo's candy store for sugar daddies before heading over to the viaduct under Route 17, where they'd gird themselves for the rocks hurled at them by the hobos sleeping there if they arrived too early and startled them. Little Pete occasionally played the role of prop. Jim and Bob would send him up unsuspecting doorsteps and ring the bell, claiming he was a starving orphan. Although the ruse rarely worked, in a town of 7,000 nearly everybody knew everybody else, Pete would often walk away with a handful of cookies anyway, which he'd share with his brothers who were hiding in the bushes. One time their target called their bluff and invited Pete inside for a meal, leaving Jim and Bob to stew in the bushes. Eventually, they had to ring the doorbell to retrieve him. That was all they left with. Pete walked out full, but empty-handed. It wasn't long before pre-adolescent Jim was in business for himself. The feeling of independence that came from walking into Slupo's with purchasing power intoxicated him by the time he was 8. "I liked the fact that I had my own ability to feed myself. Anytime there was something in the newspaper, sell chocolates door to door, whatever, okay, good, I'd send away for a kit. I liked having money in my pocket, and I liked having control over my life." He and Bob started a sports club and collected dues from the neighborhood kids, found old newspapers to sell to scrap dealers. They would store them in the garage until there was no room for George's car, at which point Bob would call the scrap dealer for the pickup, and gathered empty ice cream cups at George's fast-pitch softball games. If you collected 20 cups, you got a free ice cream from Joe Slush, who sold them out of the back of his truck at the games. Jim was always entrepreneurial, Pete recalled. He could see an opportunity and get right on it. He was great at figuring out what other people's needs were and filling them. By the fourth grade, he had business cards made up. "You name it, we'll do it," they read. Whenever someone named it, he and Bob did it. Mowing lawns, shoveling snow, whatever. Recognizing an opportunity shortly after the war, Jim started his own scrap metal business. "I'd be walking home from school, and I'd see a bolt or a fender, and I'd grab it, take it home with me, and store it in the woods part of my backyard. After a while, I had a tremendous pile." At that point, he'd flag down the man driving through the neighborhood looking for scrap metal himself. The man paid by the pound. "I think I got over $50, which is an enormous amount of money for a guy who's in third grade." When it came to sports, the Bouton boys had to make it up here as well. Rochelle Park was too small for organized youth leagues, so the summers and school year afternoons were dominated by pickup games of one sort or another. "Every day you went down to the park and you chose up sides," Jim remembered. Occasionally, they'd play stickball under the viaduct, stopping whenever a car passed through. He also played catch with George and Bob and learned very early how to throw a ball far and hard. Soon, he figured out how to make it curve. When he was 10, he turned to the back of a Wheaties box and saw a photo of old-time pitcher Dutch Leonard, along with a description of how to throw a knuckleball, a pitch that has baffled pitchers, catchers, and batters alike since it was introduced in the late 19th century. Batsmen who are accustomed to working against speedy pitchers find the floater very bothersome, wrote a perplexed Cleveland sports writer in 1908. The ball looms up to the plate as big as a Halloween pumpkin, and just as it arrives, seems to assume the proportions of a pea and fall to nothing at all. Leonard used two fingers, but my hands were too small, so I had to use three, Jim remembered. I started to throw them to my brother Bob, and finally I got one to break. He had his hands up here, by his chest, and it dropped and hit him on the kneecap. I spent the rest of that summer trying to break my brother's kneecaps. It was a difficult pitch to master, but he kept at it until he did. His knuckleball was so good, Bob remembered, that you could not follow it. It would dip, go up, down, sideways. Even he didn't know where it was going. It was dangerous. That Wheaties box would alter the course of his life. Not just that he saw it, but that he saw it when he did. The knuckleball is like the violin in that it is better learned by children, he once said. A split finger you can pick up in an hour and a half. Gripping the ball behind the seams 7 decades later, he still had the ability to make it dance. If learned with a child's grip, you'll remember it the rest of your life. The pickup games may have been informal, but to Jim at least, they meant as much as any World Series game. I was a terrible kid, he said years later. I always had to win. I was a poor sport. None of the kids liked me. I was a bad loser. I'd sulk, kick, cry, and stomp. I was awful. Bob had a front row seat for all of this throughout their years in Rochelle Park. He could not handle a situation where somebody made an error. If there was a pop fly and the second baseman dropped it, Jim would run towards him, berate him, and maybe even give him a little nudge or a kick. It was very important to him not to lose. Eventually, he had a difficult time finding teammates. Few 8-year-olds wanted to be reminded of their athletic shortcomings whenever a ball came their way. If they were looking to be on the winning side, however, there was nobody better. From the first pitch, he was intense and competitive. I'm here, and you're going to have a tough time, was his worldview, said Pete. You may beat me, but it ain't going to be easy. Let's go. I was a pretty good little ball player back then, Jim remembered. Very little. When he was 11, he played formal ball for the first time, having made his Midland Elementary School's 5th grade team. One problem, there were no uniforms small enough to fit him. Trudy had to stitch his herself. On the mound, in his homemade Midland Lions uniform, Jim realized that this is where he wanted to be, with the ball, in control, staring down a hitter. The dynamic was the purest distillation of his competitive fire, and as such, the biggest thrill of his life. Nothing would, nothing could, ever supplant it. George, himself a pitcher, for Jack's Tavern, would oftentimes bring Jim to his softball games. As the oldest and most athletically inclined, Jim seemed to be George's favorite, or at least, that's how his brothers interpreted things. Before games, little Jim Bouton would be out there with the men, shagging flies during batting practice. He was usually the only kid out there. George, Jim remembered one of his father's teammates admonishing him when he first sent his son out with the guys. Your boy's there. He's in a lot of trouble. They're hitting line drives. He's going to get hurt. No, George replied. He's not going to have any problem at all. A few minutes later, there was a screaming line drive into short center field, and Jim ran, dove, and caught it. The teammate was impressed. I guess you're right, George. I guess he's okay. From the start, George not only had confidence in Jim, but was also eager to demonstrate that confidence publicly. This filtered down. I always felt like I could do anything. His competitiveness and confidence, combined with his short stature, put Jim on the side of the underdog early on. Aside from the reality that the smallest kid on the field had no choice but to prove himself each and every time, it was just more fun to be on that side than with the guys who expected to prevail. Whenever we chose up sides for something like basketball, if there were an odd number of guys, I always wanted to be on the side where it looked like it was an impossible situation. I loved the underdog role. I'd rather lose in that sort of situation than make it easy. It was the challenge of it all he loved the most, the fun of overcoming the odds, or not, but at least trying to. In this way, he was the epitome of blue-collar Rochelle Park. "Nobody rooted for the Yankees in Rochelle Park," Jim would say. "It didn't seem sporting, like shooting fish in a barrel." Yankee fans were the kids who wanted to be on the side with five guys rather than four, who only liked the bedtime stories with happy endings. Yankee fans, we believed, were the sons of bankers who lived in towns with bigger houses and nicer lawns. Roger Angel once described the Yankees as the rich family up on the hill. Rochelle Park was at the bottom of that hill, so Rochelle Park kids rooted for either the Giants or the Dodgers. When they could swing it, the brothers trekked over to the polo grounds to root on their team of choice, the New York Giants. They'd bring their lunches, tuna fish or peanut butter sandwiches that would befoul the air by the third inning on a warm day, and cheer on Willie Mays, Whitey Lockman, and the rest. Whenever possible, they'd arrive well before game time to try to catch the players as they were entering the stadium to ask for their autographs. This by itself was not unusual. There were dozens of kids there every time, but little Jim Bouton was no doubt the only one to make sure to reserve a space between the signatures of Mays and Amalfitano for his own autograph, which he would add after the game. "I wanted to see how I would sign when I was a big league player," he said later. Not if, when. By the time Jim was 13, George was doing a little better financially, so the Boutons packed up and headed for Ridgewood, New Jersey, home of the bankers with the bigger houses and nicer lawns. Monochrome, white-collar, comfortable Ridgewood, where the Yankee fans resided. Whatever rough edges Rochelle Park presented, Ridgewood smoothed away. Here would be where young Jim Bouton would finally have the space to get serious about school and plan for his future, or at least, that was the thought. Quickly, however, it became obvious to everyone that Jim was singularly focused. He wanted to be a baseball player. So it was Bob whose academic star rose as he became the designated engineer in the family, urged by his parents and relatives to carry on the Bouton tinkerer tradition. He would eventually graduate with an engineering degree from Cornell. "Bob was more of a student, got very good grades," Pete recalled. "Jim was a decent student, but his focus was baseball. He was good, but he didn't have the focus on grades that Bob did." Thus did Bob become the engineer in waiting, and Jim become the ball player. Summer mornings would arrive with Jim urging Bob to get out of bed already because there was a ball game somewhere and they needed to be a part of it. "Why are you just reading books?" Jim would ask Bob. "Why are you studying?" he wanted to know. "Why sit at home when there are games to be played?" "I was the student," Bob recalled, "and he was the athlete." More than simply participate, Jim had an overwhelming desire to run the entire enterprise, no matter what it might be. "He liked to be the showmaker," said Bob. "He wanted to call the shots." He had in his head a vision of what needed to be done to make whatever it was, to him at least, better and more fun, even though that might not have been something other people wanted to do, Bob remembered. No matter, Jim would push them forward, bending them toward his will, undaunted. This portrait of Bouton's childhood perhaps clashes with the future image of him among his professional teammates and many of the scribes as something of a thinker, a cleated philosopher, but only upon first glance. In truth, he was very much a thinker, albeit an untraditional one who was always open to acquiring knowledge from unconventional sources, people, circumstances, the streets, rather than simply textbooks. He was every bit the tinkerer as anyone else in the Bouton household, although his smarts didn't evidence themselves on his quarterly report cards. He was simply interested in things that weren't tested in school. To the surprise of many, today, but not then, he was never much of a reader. About all he read with any regularity were the sanitized Chip Hilton books written by former basketball coach Claire B. Starting with the football-themed Touchdown Pass in 1948, these sports-themed novels for boys presented wholesome life lessons through baseball, football, and basketball that were little different from the ones sports writers were penning for their fathers in the dailies. Typically, Chip and his teammates faced obstacles that threatened their sense of teamwork and fair play. By the end, sportsmanship won out, good triumphed over evil, and virtue had been restored. The overwhelming theme of the Chip Hilton books was that to do good, one had to be good, and that the good teammate was the one who sublimated his own interest for the good of the team. If he were fictionalized, Mickey Mantle could have been Chip Hilton, given how he was typically portrayed. Jim thrived in Ridgewood. He professionalized his business cards, printing dozens of them in the school's print shop, and generating enough business doing whatever for whomever to ensure that he always had money in his pocket. Although he may have been so-so in the classroom, once the bell rang and after-school sports began, there was nobody better. In monochrome Ridgewood, where white families were comfortable and black ones mostly a rumor, a kid like Jim, who wanted it more than anyone else, who needed to win, couldn't help but succeed. He was an all-sports star in high school, excelling no matter what the sport, no matter what the season. He may not have been the biggest or the fastest, but nobody in Ridgewood High competed harder than Jim Bouton. Provided he never left its protective bubble, that would be enough. In 1954, after his freshman year at Ridgewood, the bubble burst. By that time, George had long since moved on from selling pressure cookers to become an operations manager at American Manganese. Offered an opportunity to run their plant in Indiana, George jumped and relocated the family just across the state line in Homewood, Illinois. That quickly, Ridgewood High was in Jim's rearview mirror. Homewood itself was not all that different from Ridgewood, but it, along with many of the neighboring towns, lacked its own high school. Instead, it served as one tributary of many to sprawling Bloom Township High School, which took students from all of them. Located in Chicago Heights, one of the most industrial communities in the country after World War II, Bloom was everything Ridgewood High was not. It was large, it was diverse, and it could be brutal. Each town, monochromatic as it might have been, sent its young to Bloom, where everyone was stirred together. Chicago Heights would have been a culture shock on its own, replete as it was with factories, steel mills, and foundries, the prototypical lunch bucket community. Add in the multitude of races, classes, and ethnicities from the neighboring towns, and it became a salad bowl of American society. This was not Ridgewood, Bob remembered. Instead, this is where the real world is. It was an eye-opener in more ways than one. Bloom had nearly 4,000 students in all. When Jim arrived, he became little more than simply one of approximately 1,000 sophomores, more of a statistic than a star. "I had acne and braces, and I was miserable," he recalled years later. "Worse, no one knew I was a hero." He was hardly that. Bloom was a factory for athletes. Merely making a squad was an accomplishment. Forget about being the star. Just as he had in Ridgewood, he tried out for the varsity football and basketball teams. He was cut by both. In the spring, he tried out for the baseball team and barely managed to survive the final cut for the freshman and sophomore squad. Little matter, as he barely played anyway. He was warm-up Bouton, as he liked to describe himself years later, always in the bullpen, never in the game. Looking back, most notably in Ball 4, He always described this period with great humor, but at the time, the competitor in him seethed. His confidence was such that he knew he was every bit as good as the kids out there. He just wasn't being given the chance. As he saw it, there was an entrenched star system at Bloom, with the coach's hand-picked favorites being given the starting positions before the seasons even began. Nothing offended his competitive nature more deeply. Although there was little he could do to change the coach's minds, he was determined to at least show the stars themselves that he was very much their equal. He recruited Bob, along with a ragtag collection of kids from the neighborhood, and challenged the first-teamers to a game of street football, to be played not on the manicured football field in Bloom's state-of-the-art stadium, but in the backyards of Homewood, among the rocks, trees, hills, and ridges. With Jim at quarterback and Bob as his receiver, they won. They challenged them again and beat them once more, and then again. Perhaps the stars didn't take the game seriously. It was simply an after-school backyard get-together to them. But to Jim, the games meant everything. He was not going to lose, and so he didn't. Now more than ever, he identified with the underdog. No longer simply a fun construct self-created to test himself, this time the status was imposed on him by the structure and culture at Bloom. Nearly every day he bore witness to some form of manifestation of the strong preying upon the weak. Pete, however, bore the brunt most directly. Ripped from his comfortable existence in Ridgewood at 9 years old, he was thrust into a world he was hardly prepared for. "What a terrible time for me," he recalled. "It was fighting on your way to school, fighting on your way from school. I was bullied all the time." Although Jim and Bob continued to tease Pete mercilessly themselves, one time devising a rigged ping-pong tournament in the basement with a milkshake for the victor, then throwing the games to Pete, compelling him to down the concoction spiked with salt and vinegar as his prize, Jim began stepping in to recalibrate the scales whenever he noticed an imbalance of power. Jim appointed himself Bob's protector, and Jim and Bob both took charge of protecting Pete. "One day I was followed home by a group of boys who wanted to beat the crap out of me," Pete recalled. "There was a foray on a neighbor's lawn where I was getting jabbed in all directions by three different guys. You didn't know who to defend yourself from first. Suddenly, Jim and Bob showed up. I was crying. There were at least six kids jeering at me, poking and grabbing at me. Jim said to them, 'You're not going to all fight him at once. You want to fight him? You fight him one at a time.' So they picked out one of the kids, and I beat the shit out of the kid while Jim and Bob held the other kids back. Then they said, 'You want to do this again? Then come on over one at a time.' I never saw those kids again." In the schoolyard as well, whenever he'd see a kid crying, he'd step in to see what was wrong. "He was always looking out for the kids who couldn't defend themselves," said Bob. He'd then administer his own form of justice by punching their tormentors in the nose. Sometimes he'd apologize later for bloodying them. Still, the message had been sent. As an underdog himself, he soon recognized the steps he'd have to take to rebalance the scales in his own life. Reluctantly, he decided to rechannel his energies away from football and basketball and focus solely on baseball. It was the only way he could ever even have a hope of making the varsity before graduation. Years later, he believed that the pressures of Bloom turned him into a major league pitcher. "If I had stayed at Ridgewood and had it easy, I probably wouldn't have made it. I'd have played all sports, been a jack of all trades, and master of none." The benefits were not immediately forthcoming. The coaches might have had their hand-picked favorites, but there were some legitimate stars on every squad. On the varsity baseball team, future National Basketball Association NBA executive Jerry Colangelo was a southpaw curveball specialist who was the ace of the staff and drawing the interest of professional scouts. Other players were being recruited by major colleges, such as powerhouse Arizona State. Once Jim lasered in on baseball, he succeeded in making the varsity as a junior, but rarely made it into the games. He was still warm-up Bouton, as coach Fred Jacobite often turned to infielders or outfielders when he needed a relief pitcher rather than the skinny 145-pound kid loosening up in the bullpen. "I was the number one pitcher, and Jimmy was behind me," Colangelo recalled. To say he was having trouble adjusting to the level of competition at Bloom was an understatement. He was very, very competitive. I saw that firsthand. There were times when, out of frustration, Jim frustrated some of the guys. I remember one day by our lockers, I had to break up a potentially bad scene between Jim and another athlete. He could be a little edgy from time to time. Ultimately, he had someone on his side, one of those coaches he dismissed upon his arrival at Bloom for playing the star system. Coach Fred Jacobite may have at first passed Bouton over for his infielders and outfielders when the games were on the line, but at heart, he was a scrapper, a competitor just like Jim was. "He was all banged up all the time," was how Colangelo remembered Jacobite. Hobbling onto the field with two bad knees wrapped in braces, he never begged off, no matter what. Jim didn't realize it yet, but Jacobite was just the sort of coach who would see the value in what he had to offer. "Jim was a fireballing right-hander," Jacobite remembered. A kid who seemingly threw everything he had into every pitch, so much so that his hat flew off nearly every time. Throughout his career, coaches, professional as well as those who simply considered themselves experts, would shake their heads in disapproval whenever they watched him pitch, admonishing him to adjust his delivery. Not Jacobite. They'd tell him, "You've got to see that ball go into the glove. Your head has got to come through before the rest of your body." And you looked at him. He was darn near looking at first base when he ended up. He followed through so far. But he was throwing harder than the kids who were practicing what the ordained experts preached. So be it, Jacobite figured. If it worked for Jim, that was good enough. Regardless, there simply wasn't a spot for him in the rotation during his junior year. The talent was seemingly bottomless at Bloom. Short, skinny Jim Bouton just could not get on the field. "Jim was so deep in the varsity pitching staff," John Myers, a local sports writer who covered the squad, recalled years later. "It was hard to find him." After a lost season in the Bloom bullpen, he tried out for a Chicago Heights American Legion team managed by Earl Detella. Here, he figured, he might have a shot at taking the mound in an actual game. Many of his teammates at Bloom took the summers off and didn't play Legion ball. Regardless, he was taking no chances. "I was the first kid at the ballpark along the Dixie Highway," Jim remembered. "Earl was already there, and he said, 'What are you?' I told him I was a pitcher, and he told me to throw a few to him. The same thing happened the next night, and then Earl said, 'You'll start our first game.'" He not only pitched, but also helped manicure the field before games and get it into shape after it rained. "Bouton, you're my pitcher," he remembered Detella telling him, words he hadn't heard in a long time. Given the opportunity, he thrived, quickly becoming the ace of Detella's staff. Meyer covered those games also. He was impressed. So impressed that he penned an open letter in the Chicago Heights Star, suggesting to Jacobite that he would do very well to take a long look at Jim Bouton the following spring when baseball season started again. Jacobite was reaching the same conclusions on his own. He incorporated ballroom dance in his physical education classes and was impressed by how easily Bouton took to it, by how well and athletically he moved. Soon, they developed a rapport such that Jim would wait on the corner every morning for Jacobite to drive by and pick him up on his way to school. This time, there was little chance that Bouton would be just another anonymous arm when baseball resumed in the spring. And Meyer, Detella, and Jacobite weren't the only ones who by this point had taken notice of him. William K. W.K. Fred, a Chicagoland bird dog scout who once had a loose affiliation with the St. Louis Browns, caught a few of Bouton's Legion games and tipped off a friend of his, Art Stewart, who managed another area Legion club, this one with a higher level of talent than Detella's. Stewart had a loose affiliation of his own. He was a part-time scout with the New York Yankees, who had him run a club in the Chicago area called, appropriately enough, the Chicago Yankees, in the hope that maybe he'd unearth a gem or two in the process. Fred made his living by taking the streetcar from one Chicago park to another, looking for players he could recommend to the full-time scouts. Even though he made his living on the run, he was at all times dressed in a suit and tie, topped always by a fedora. Many of his fellow strap hangers naturally assumed the nattily attired man standing next to them was most likely a banker on his way to a real estate closing. He hardly fitted the mold of the grizzled hustler beating the bushes for raw, unpolished baseball talent. "I was always nice to Fred," Stewart recalled. "That was why he tipped me off on things, even though I worked for the Yankees. So he told me, 'You know, there's a young junior over at Bloom. He'd be worth taking a look at and having on your club. He could help you.'" Fred was a friend, but there was more to it than that. Fred wanted to see how Bouton would fare against better competition than he was facing with Detella's squad. If he performed well, maybe Fred could recommend the young pitcher to one of the full-time scouts he knew, and perhaps collect a commission for doing so. Stewart marked Bouton's name down in his notebook, and then promptly forgot about it. 2. Take a hike, son. Art Stewart and W.K. Fred lived in a world that Bouton barely knew existed. His extended little farther than Homewood and the Bloom High campus, where, as far as he was concerned, life had moved on. Fall had arrived, school was back in session, baseball was on the distant horizon, and he had by now given up his pursuits of football and basketball. Facing the void, he rediscovered a childhood passion, watercolors. He had always had an interest in art. His great aunt had graduated from art school, and as a child he enjoyed watching her work. And in art, it didn't matter if you were too small to grip a knuckleball the way Dutch Leonard showed you on the back of a Wheaties box. As he grew and learned how to throw hard, baseball began to dominate his life. Still, he never completely abandoned this other interest. Now, at Bloom, it flourished. Sometimes, when asked, he'd say that Hoyt Wilhelm was his hero. But sometimes he'd say, no, Wilhelm was great, but his true hero was John Marin, the early to mid-century abstract art pioneer who specialized in watercolors. At Bloom, he took some art classes, which rekindled his passion. Once he had enough for a portfolio of watercolors, charcoals, and oils, he entered a contest held by the Homewood Flosswood Women's Club. He placed third, good enough for an all-expense-paid 2-week course at the Art Institute of Chicago. This led to an invitation to show his work at the avant-garde Gold Coast Art Show on Rush Street. Jim and Bob piled his paintings and etchings into the back of the family car and set off, setting up alongside artists of various stripes. While most artists considered the show primarily a platform by which to display their work, Jim and Bob saw it differently. Whereas the other artists priced their work at $400 or $500 apiece, Jim and Bob held, in essence, an everything-must-go closeout sale, undercutting the competition by offering Jim's paintings for $4 each, $3.98, two for $7. Despite being perhaps the most inexperienced artist there, his quickly became the most popular booth at the show. Crowds swelled around the high school art student from Homewood. Within 2 hours, his inventory was gone. Jim and Bob returned home 15 paintings lighter and with about $60 in their pockets. He then expanded into jewelry making. When he could find it, he'd melt silver or gold. When he couldn't, other metals would do. Whatever he could scrounge up. He learned how to make wax impressions and then cast them in plaster to create a mold in which to pour his metals. He'd look for interesting driveway stones to polish as centerpieces for the rings, bracelets, and necklaces he'd create and then sell. Few of his customers realized that the ring they were admiring was largely composed of discarded materials strewn about their neighborhood just days earlier. The cold slap of athletic reality at Bloom caused Bouton to wonder whether his future lay as a commercial artist rather than as a pitcher. Art, he realized, could be a satisfying means toward a financial end. He loved art itself, but he also loved the attention it brought him, along with the idea that people would pay him for his work. On its own, art was a hobby, but blended with his knack for making a buck and ability to draw a crowd, he saw how this could be a lifestyle. He burnished other interests while waiting for baseball season to start up again. He took a deep dive into the Chicago music scene, although here he was more in the audience than up on the stage. He fell in love with blues, jazz, and soul music after his dial found an obscure radio show broadcast out of the South Side late one night. "This is Sam Evans," the show would begin, "and I'm in the basement with the blue light on drinking Orange Tommy, the screwdriver in a bottle, and you're listening to Jammin' with Sam." Jim and Bob would listen enraptured through the night and early morning, keeping the volume down so as not to wake the rest of the house. Sam would tell stories and spin records. Real records. Black records, before they were co-opted by whites, Jim would say. And real stories. Not ones that had been scrubbed, rinsed, and sanitized, told not by a polished, professionalized DJ, but by a guy sitting in his basement on the south side of Chicago drinking supercharged screwdrivers. They never had heard anything like it. Later, Jim took a job with the Chicago Heights Park District, where he organized pickup games for inner-city kids. The games themselves were fun, but what he really enjoyed was listening to the stories these kids told him every time he went there, the language they used, the banter between them. All of it, unedited, unpolished, fascinated him. Often he'd come home full of tales and anecdotes, looking for someone to unload them on. Most of the time he found Bob and shared with him everything he had heard. As he matured, so did his tastes. As soon as it was released, he became enamored of the movie On the Waterfront, along with its star Marlon Brando. Brando's cool, yoked-together defiance and vulnerability, a critic would later write. The side glances of thwarted hope with kinetic explosions of righteous anger. All of this spoke to him. In the dock worker and shamed boxer Terry Malloy, Jim witnessed the melding of defiance and vulnerability, as well as what another critic at the time described as a single human soul caught in the contradictions and absurdity of modern life. This was no Chip Hilton story. The film offered up an anti-hero for a protagonist, a conflicted individual who remained unsatisfied and alone as the credits rolled. So when Jim leaned over the Wrigley Field dugout at about this time to get Giants shortstop Alvin Dark's autograph, as he recounted in Ball 4, he could not have been shocked at Dark's response. "Take a hike, son, take a hike." After all he'd experienced since leaving the cocoon of Ridgewood, he knew by now that life was far more complex and messy than the sanitized tales he'd ingested as a child. If anything, Dark's take a hike could only have suggested to him that baseball was in fact no different from anything else. The sports writers were wrong. In his own backhanded way, Dark had imparted upon him a fundamental truth. At long last, spring rolled around. Even before the ice melted, it was clear that finally he was going to get his shot. His successes in Legion Ball, along with the open letter in the Star and his burgeoning relationship with Jacobite, made it impossible for him to fade into the background any longer. More immediately, Colangelo had all but thrown out his arm by this point, and worse, suffered a broken hand in the off-season, leaving what was left of his arm shrunken and withered. Jacobite now had a need in the rotation. Somebody would have to step up. Jacobite gave Bouton the ball and watched him become a star. As a senior, he flourished and led Bloom to the state finals, where he pitched 14 innings in a 2-1 defeat. Warm-up Bouton was now the ace. Testament to how far he had come at Bloom since his arrival came 8 years later, when the school inaugurated the Jim Bouton 110% Award, given to the athlete who put forth the most effort in any school sport during the previous year. It paid for the 57-inch trophy with the money Bouton refused to accept upon returning to Bloom a few years later for a sports banquet. Despite Bouton's successes on the Bloom High Mound, Art Stewart was none the wiser. The note he jotted down at W.K. Fred's insistence the previous summer was by this point swimming in the sea of names, places, and other details he had accumulated in the months since, seemingly lost amid the marginalia. Thankfully, for Stewart, as much as Bouton, fate would intervene. One afternoon, Stewart got word that Colangelo was going to take the mound again, so he, along with a busload of other scouts who had likewise had their eyes on Colangelo for a while now, trekked over to Bloom to see if he still had it. Colangelo warmed up, but right before game time felt a twinge in his arm and was scratched. At that point, the busload of scouts began chatting among themselves about a third baseman from Kankakee, Indiana, who was worth taking a look at. It was only a short drive across the state line to see him, so they all piled back into their cars and headed off. Stewart stayed.
"I was a young scout at the time," he recalled, "and I was ready to go too. And then I remembered something that one of the greatest scouts who ever lived told me."
The scout was Paul Critchell, the famed Yankee scout who signed Lou Gehrig, Tony Lazzeri, Whitey Ford, and Phil Rizzuto, along with dozens of other household names.
"One of the things he always told me was this: when you get to the ballpark, never leave early, no matter what. So with that, I stayed."
Stewart settled in, more out of professional obligation than anything else. Suddenly, he was drawn to the sound rather than the sight of Colangelo's replacement, who was loosening up on a nearby practice mound.
"I'm hearing this smack, smack, smack down the line of this kid warming up. He's only about 5'10 and 150, 160 pounds. And I said, geez, this kid's got a pretty good arm. I went to the coach and said, 'What's his name?' He says, 'Jim Bouton.' And then it all came back to me."
Stewart searched through his notebook and found the tip from Fred. The young pitcher then took the mound and dominated, striking out 16 batters. Fred had been right. Jim Bouton could help him in more ways than he could possibly know at the time. 3. Joliet. Once he had discovered Bouton, Art Stewart made sure that nobody else did.
"I pitched him out of Chicago as much as I could," he recalled.
His favorite diamond for his diamond in the rough was the one inside the barricaded walls of the infamous Joliet Correctional Center. Here was where some of the most hardened rapists and murderers served their time and occasionally played ball on a beautifully manicured field designed by the Cubs' longtime head groundskeeper, Bobby Doerr, and maintained by a lucky few of them. Professional scouts routinely followed Stewart's club around, but they found reasons to be elsewhere when he scheduled games against one or another of the region's penitentiaries. It was in these games that Stewart would unleash his brightest prospects, the prison walls affording him the privacy to judge their abilities away from the prying eyes of his scouting competitors. The visuals were surreal as Stewart's Legion Yankees took the Joliet prison yard field in old New York Yankee uniforms, supplied by the big club itself. Stewart wore Rizzuto's old frayed number 10 on his back.
"I remember the first game Jim pitched there," Stewart said. "About 15 to 20 minutes before the game, they marched the prisoners out. There were over 1,000 of them, and Jim's warming up and throwing pretty hard."
Sizing up the competition, the prisoners began to make their wagers.
"They bet cigarettes. Most of them would bet against the home team, because they hate them, because they get the opportunity to work on the field and play ball, while the rest of them sit in their cells."
After watching Bouton warm up, the heavy money, or tobacco, was on him. He delivered. After throwing a two-hitter and striking out several of the inmates, he left the field to a thunderous roar. Stewart could hide him for only so long. Competing within the Chicago Parks League, he had no choice but to pitch him in the playoff games, in front of everybody. In this era before the implementation of baseball's amateur draft, scouts were continually at war with each other, each attempting to hoard their finds for their respective clubs. As a Legion coach as well as a part-time scout, Stewart faced an unsolvable conflict of interest. As a coach, his job was to win games and play his best players, but as a part-time scout, his loyalty ran to the New York Yankees, who Stewart hoped might promote him to full-time if he was able to present them with top-notch talent. In Bouton, Stewart knew he had a bona fide prospect on his hands, and after Bouton pitched his club to the Legion World Series in Battle Creek, Michigan, every other scout did as well.
"He pitched against one of the big powerhouses," Stewart remembered, "and beat him. There were about 40 scouts in the stands, and I said, 'Uh-oh, that's it. They all know about Jim Bouton now.'"
Although he could have entertained offers from numerous scouts at that point, Jim, guided by George, decided that another year of amateur seasoning was preferable. After driving past the Western Michigan University, WMU, campus one day and admiring its baseball diamond, George doubled back, picked up some brochures from the admissions office, and took them home to his son. Western Michigan had a strong baseball program that intrigued the Boutons for a couple of reasons. It had sent a large handful of players to the majors over the course of the previous two decades, but was small enough to be a place where Jim might once more be able to stand out. Unbeknownst to Jim, at around this time, a top catching prospect from Detroit was also considering Western Michigan. His name was Bill Freehan, and in 1958, he did in fact enroll. He transferred shortly thereafter to Michigan, however. Freehan would himself write a controversial baseball memoir, Behind the Mask, which was a diary of his 1969 season with the Detroit Tigers and released a few months before Ball 4 in 1970. But for a couple of last-minute decisions by both Bouton and Freehan, WMU might very well have fielded, at least in retrospect, baseball's first tell-all battery. The scouts might have been courting Jim, but the coaching staff at WMU had never heard of him. George fixed that. He sent the head coach an anonymous letter praising the phenom from Bloom High School. He stuffed the envelope with Jim's press clippings as an exclamation point. The coach was intrigued. He called Jim, took him to lunch, and eventually agreed to put him on the freshman squad to see what he had. If he did well, he might gain a scholarship and join the varsity as a sophomore, he offered. George and Jim found the arrangement acceptable, so in the fall of 1957, Jim headed off for Western Michigan University, where, rather than being a professional pitcher in one of the organizations willing to sign him that summer, he would begin the season as the fourth starter on the freshman team. Once settled in at WMU, he joined the baseball frat, Delta Sigma Phi, and very quickly made a name for himself among his brethren. One day, frat brother Jim Charlton remembered, he led his pledge class on an elaborate raid of the fraternity house. It was an old Victorian mansion, and the raid involved bringing in farm animals, a smoke machine, and bricking up the front door so you couldn't get out. It was a very elaborate and time-consuming plan. He then decided to run for a leadership position within the fraternity. It didn't go well. While his brothers appreciated his sense of humor, some chafed at the range as well as the amount of Bouton's opinions. He received only 4 votes. It was an early indicator to him that life offered up choices, and here was one of them. With his looks, ability, and charisma, he would have little trouble being backslapped into the cloistered world of the insider if he constrained himself to conform to the insider's code. Or he could speak his mind and not worry about the code, but reside on the outside looking in. Events like this one, minor in the grand scheme of things, reminded him that there was no escaping the choice. At Delta Sigma Phi, as he would everywhere else over the next half century, he chose the latter. Baseball went better. By the end of the year, he was the number one pitcher on the freshman squad and primed to be promoted to the varsity the following season. Although his practical side pulled him toward finance as a major, his artistic side drove him toward WMU's art department. After sizing up its offerings, he decided to enroll in an advanced watercolors course. Upon being informed that he first needed to take several preparatory courses before he would be eligible for the class, he balked. Eventually, he argued his way into the class, making an arrangement with the professor that if he couldn't keep up with the more advanced students, he would drop the course. He wound up with an A. At around the same time, he was enrolled in a communications class when another student tried to argue her way into that course. She was Barbara Heister, a fellow freshman from Allegan, Michigan, who was trying to switch classes after the second semester had already begun. The professor left the decision to admit her up to the students. Led by Jim, several of the boys clapped their approval, and she was in. A few weeks later, it was Twerp Week at WMU, their version of Sadie Hawkins Day, where the woman is required to pay. Barbara, or Bobby as she was called, asked out the good-looking guy who stood up for her earlier in the semester. They went to the student union, where Bobby did most of the talking, and on the subject she was most passionate about, baseball. She was not only a rabid Detroit Tigers fan, but also the official statistician for her high school newspaper and kept score for the baseball team. At WMU, she continued to keep score, although this time unofficially from the stands. She had only made it to the varsity games. She had no idea that her date was pitching on the freshman team. Finally, he fessed up. They talked some more baseball, but about other things as well. Bobby started showing up at the freshman games, and soon they became a couple. It didn't take her long to realize that her new boyfriend was not a typical jock. He was knowledgeable about politics and causes and liked talking about both. He introduced her to costume jewelry making, and soon she developed an interest in that as well. After they were married, they bought buffers and grinders and each made their own lines of jewelry. He was not one-dimensional, Bobby recalled. His interests were wide-ranging, but undergirding all of it was the heart of a bulldog. He certainly was competitive, and that would come out in just playing cards or putting together a jigsaw puzzle, but that's probably what made him succeed. Bobby helped him measure his success. She soon began charting his starts, keeping track of his innings pitched, strikeouts, walks, earned runs, and overall performance. In the far right-hand column of her personalized Jim Bouton stat sheet came her overall assessment of each start: excellent, good, fair, or bad. She never had the opportunity to chart one of his games for the varsity, though. Although in retrospect, Bouton is often recalled as being one of the greats in WMU baseball history, he never advanced beyond the freshman squad. He was gone before he could. His best game at WMU was most likely not even an official one, coming in the annual alumni game the fall of his sophomore year, shortly before he signed with the Yankees. Jim and Bobby would continue to date over the course of the next few years. Eventually, she graduated, Jim never did, although he returned several times to take various classes and then took more classes at Fairleigh Dickinson after he joined the Yankees, with a degree in social psychology. She moved to suburban Philadelphia and became a social worker, dealing with delinquent adolescents. This amused Jim to no end. He liked to tell people that he was her first client. On December 23, 1962, they were married in Bobby's hometown of Allegan. Jim was in the U.S. Army Reserve stationed in Fort Dix at the time, so Bobby had to make all the arrangements. On the day of the ceremony, Bob officially assumed the role he had played throughout his brother's childhood. He was Jim's best man. 4. You should write a book. After his successful season on the freshman squad at WMU, Bouton returned to Art Stewart and the Chicago Yankees for a second season of Legion ball with that club. He dominated again, and again the scouts appeared to be curious. After some back and forth that revealed their limited interest in him as a prospect, George decided to become proactive and force the issue. He drew up a letter announcing that his son would sign for $30,000. And sent it to every scout that at one time or another had at least shown cursory interest. Maybe, he hoped, he could ignite a bidding war. Letters went to scouts from the White Sox, Braves, Indians, Phillies, Dodgers, Yankees, Cardinals, and Tigers. It was a decidedly unsophisticated campaign. The letter to the Philadelphia scout identified his employer as the Phillies, P-H-I-L-L-Y-S. W.K. Fred also sent some letters. The goal was to smoke out those who had genuine interest and to cause those who were more reluctant to rethink their positions. George was confident that Jim would sign somewhere eventually, as he told him in a letter congratulating him on his successful start in the fall game against the alumni. Was glad to hear how well you did against some pros. They're human too, so can be fooled, but it takes real control, stuff, and resourcefulness to fool the big leaguers consistently. That's the main thing you'll develop in your first pro years. George explained to Jim that his letters to the scouts should bring the whole thing to a head real soon. If anyone was sufficiently interested, they'd sign. Otherwise, we'll stop the whole matter till after school next spring. In the meantime, George assured Jim that he was maintaining contact with Art Stewart. Through it all, the Yankees seemed to be Jim's most likely destination. The initial returns were not promising. The White Sox and Dodgers returned unresponsive responses, and the Braves recommended that Bouton return to school for at least another year, if not two. At that point, perhaps, the Braves' Chicago area scout suggested, "I think he will be a valuable prospect." He reiterated that his prior offer to sign Jim, made in Battle Creek, Michigan at the Legion tournament, still stood, but that $30,000 was too rich for his blood. That amount in 1958 dollars certainly sounded on the surface like a lot, but as George and Jim were to learn, sometimes $30,000 wasn't exactly $30,000. Upon Stewart's urging, however, the Yankees responded more favorably. The great Yankee second baseman Jerry Coleman had just retired and was named personnel director as preparation for a new career in the front office. One of his first official duties was to work with Stewart to sign Bouton. "He was learning all the facets of the front office," Stewart recalled, "so they gave him the figures to give to me. He called me from Washington during the winter meetings." One day, Coleman himself showed up to help woo Jim, which set the whole Bouton house abuzz. Still, Stewart remained the driving force in Jim's signing. "Knowing Jim and playing for me, we were close. The folks invited me for Thanksgiving dinner, and we signed him. Over Thanksgiving dinner, 1958. On Coleman's authorization, Stewart was able to meet George's demand for a $30,000 contract, $30,250 to be exact, but when he broke it down for them, it was clear that this contract was hardly too rich for anybody's blood. In actuality, Jim's bonus upon signing a contract with the most successful organization in American sports was a big, fat zero. Instead, his bonus was to be paid in $5,000 increments over each of the next 3 years. On top of this, he would receive a typical minor league salary of $500 per month for the 3 6-month playing seasons during that time. The final $6,250 was waiting for him if he ever happened to make it to the big leagues. Annually speaking, $9,000, when it was all added up, was certainly not bad when considering that the minimum major league salary at the time was $6,000, but hardly terms that projected confidence on behalf of a club that they were signing a top-drawer prospect. Nevertheless, the signing would alter the lives of the two people most directly involved in it. Bouton's, obviously, but also Art Stewart's. Bouton's signing was Stewart's first, and in a few years, Bouton would also be the first of his signings to make it to the big leagues. Once Jim won 20 games with the Yankees, Stewart's career was made. "Now, among your fellow scouts and competitors, you're recognized. Hey, that guy signed Jim Bouton." Stewart would go on to sign 70 future major league players, such as Carlos Beltran and Johnny Damon, but Jim Bouton would be the springboard to all of that. One person whose life was not altered by the signing was W.K. Fred. Neither Stewart nor the Yankees threw anything his way for his initial tip to Stewart 2 years earlier,
so Fred began hounding George and Jim for a cut of the signing bonus and subsequent salaries once he reached the Yankees. A couple of months after Bouton signed with the Yankees, Fred found out about it third hand and wrote Bouton to remind him of his role in his development. Fred made it a point to let Jim know that although a couple of scouts from the Orioles were likewise impressed with his performance as a member of Earl Detella's Legion squad, it was W.K. Fred, the part-time man, who made contact with you. Jim, I outlined a plan to you that your parents approved, which would afford you the opportunity to pitch for a good ball club, gaining experience, and incidentally, placing your pitching wares on display before important people. I am certain that the Bouton family will not be slow to acknowledge that my plan successfully produced in every respect. Fred went on. I consider that Mr. Stewart was very remiss in failing to contact me, bringing me up to date. It must be that Stewart long since has informed his New York Yankee brass, capital B-R-A-S-S, where and how he was able to come up with pitching Jim Bouton. That fine lad and pitcher proceeded to be the ace, capital A-C-E, of Stewart's pitching staff for two seasons. All of this resulted in material gain to all parties concerned to date, with one exception. After going on to inform Jim that his mother had passed away 6 years earlier and, I continue to miss her terribly, he signed off as Jim Bouton's friend and discoverer. The letters would continue over the course of the next several years. Some would gently prod the Boutons for a share of Jim's salary. Others would not so gently prod. After Bouton won 20 games in 1963, Fred suggested that he was entitled to $1,000 to $2,000 of his $10,500 salary. Eventually, Bouton sent him some money, but still, the letters persisted. Bouton reported to the Yankees' Class D affiliate in Kearney, Nebraska in the spring of 1959 to begin his professional career. It was a short-season league, and he struggled from start to finish, ending with a 5.40 earned run average, ERA. Regardless, he wasn't afraid to be a man apart. When the Topps bubblegum people sent him a contract for a whopping $5 in exchange for the right to put his picture on a baseball card, he refused to sign, believing the terms to be unfair. He was the only minor leaguer to refuse to sign the contract. From Kearney, he moved on to Auburn, another Class D club in the New York Penn League, to finish the year, and once again struggled, compiling a 5.73 ERA before breaking his pitching hand on a line drive hit back to the box. He was used inconsistently on both squads, sometimes starting, sometimes relieving, never being able to settle into any sort of rhythm. He also struggled with some of the cultural realities of professional baseball. Before a game against the Holdridge White Sox, manager Jim Gleason encouraged his pitchers to throw at a Holdridge hitter whom Gleason suspected of filing his spikes. On the clubhouse wall was an outline of the player in his batting stance, with sections marked like the cow illustration in the butcher shop, Bouton recalled years later. It was a contest for the pitchers, with certain areas worth more points. Bouton entered the game in relief, and, as instructed, threw his first pitch behind the batter's head in a high point zone. The batter froze, and the ball just missed his helmet, hitting his bat instead. It dribbled to Bouton, who threw him out. The experience shook him up. He never intentionally threw at a batter again, although he managed to plunk more than his share throughout his career, if inadvertently. On another night in Kearney, he was exposed to a cultural reality of a different sort when he and three teammates were jumped by eight local toughs who wanted to teach what they considered these privileged interlopers a lesson. Although not much came of it physically, Bouton bore witness to what he would later describe as the disconnect between the people looking to get back at the world and the ballplayers walking around like they own it. He returned home after the 1959 season, frustrated, but also full of stories. Around the dinner table, he would recount them to George and Trudy. Funny stories, sad stories, stories of the real life of the professional baseball player. he would express his frustration over how he was used, how his teammates got along, or not, and how they viewed the outside world, as well as how the outside world viewed them. They were not the sorts of stories that could be found in the sports section. So to George and Trudy, they were fascinating, surprising, revealing, humorous, poignant. "You should write a book," Trudy suggested one evening. "Yeah, right," was essentially Jim's response. He had more immediate concerns. He needed to do something before the 1960 season if he wanted to keep his major league dream alive. Convinced that he needed to bulk up if he hoped to succeed, he put himself on a high-fat diet in preparation for the season. He downed 3 or 4 milkshakes fortified with raw eggs daily, dipped everything in gravy, and ate no matter what his stomach told him. In 2 months, he had put on 30 pounds and given himself a stomach condition that would plague him for the rest of his life. He also took steps to extricate himself from the Yankee organization. He enlisted Fred to air his grievances over how his coaches used him during the 59 season and to nose around other organizations to see if they might be interested in trading for him. It was a breach of baseball etiquette that was not well received. White Sox scout Jack Sheehan replied to Fred's entreaty with a stern admonition. "Apparently, Bouton has much faith in you, and I think you might do him a favor by pointing out to him that pro baseball is probably the most competitive business in the world, and each year he will have to compete with others to prove he is better, and that every major league system is primarily interested in each and every one of their players becoming big leaguers just as fast as possible, and they never do anything to prevent that. He had an ordinary record with a 5.40 ERA. He was injured, and the club took good care of him, and he should be appreciative rather than critical." Despite his struggles in Class D ball, Bouton was promoted in 1960 to the Yankees' Class B affiliate, Greensboro, in the Carolina League. He arrived in town hard on the heels of the civil rights movement. The Greensboro Woolworth lunch counter sit-in had begun just 2 months earlier. The town was in chaos, but his concerns were more personal. Just as he had in 1959, he struggled on the mound. At one point, George, Trudy, Bob, and Pete decided to take a trip to see him pitch. "We all got in the car. It took about a day and a half to get down there," Bob recalled. "We were saying, we may never see this again. He was about 5 levels down in the bottom of the barrel of the minor leagues." If they were ever going to see him pitch professionally, they figured that they had better do it now. "We could at least say, gee, we saw Jim pitch as a professional baseball player. Wasn't that a nice thing to see?" After a few games, the family left, but shortly thereafter, Bob returned, this time with Bobby, and they began to follow Jim around the Carolina League. Their presence seemed to settle him, and he began to have some success. Bob had about 6 weeks of free time during the summer to kill, but because Bobby was working her way through WMU, she had to have a job if she was going to spend a significant amount of time in Greensboro. Jim very badly wanted her there with him, so he finagled a job for her in a restaurant along with a place to stay. With that, she quit her job in Michigan and headed south. When she arrived, she found her new employer accommodating. She was allowed to arrange her schedule such that she was usually free come game time. While the games provided a sense of familiarity for Bobby, nearly everything outside of the ballpark was as if it were in a foreign language. Almost nothing in Allegan was as it was in a civil rights-era southern town. Everything was different. The food, the mores, everything. Race was sucking up most of the oxygen. It hovered over the totality of everyone's life. At work, the conversation among the waitresses often turned to the Woolworth sit-in and what they might do if a black customer attempted to be served in their restaurant. Most were adamant. They would ignore him. Bobby said otherwise, but this was within the cocoon of their conversation, without the glare of the nation on her as the customer sat in her presence with a menu in his hand. there was seemingly no end to the otherwise meaningless interactions that were now fraught with complications. One day, Bobby was walking on the sidewalk in town and noticed a black man walking in the other direction toward her. Right before their paths crossed, he stepped off the sidewalk and continued on, in the street. Bobby stopped, turned to him, and pleaded, "Oh no, please don't do that." He just smiled and kept on walking. As the season progressed, Bouton thrived. He ended the season going 14-8 with a sparkling 2.73 ERA. He was the staff workhorse, starting 24 games and completing half of them. He led the staff in innings pitched and, even though he wasn't throwing at anybody, batters hit by pitch. He was one of the hardest throwers on the club, but also the wiliest. He had a number of different pitches in his arsenal that he might throw at any given moment. Sometimes he had no idea where they were going. The only thing he was sure of was that he was going to outthink, outwork, and in the end, beat the competition. And he was not shy about saying so. The offensive star of the club was future Yankee utility infielder Phil Lintz, who was often on the receiving end of Jim's coffee shop theories on what made a winner and what separated the winners from the losers. Bouton would tell Lintz that there were two types of people in the world, those who thought like winners and those who thought like losers, and if one was able to train his brain properly, he could overcome nearly anything. To Lintz, he appeared to be walking proof of that. When he arrived in St. Petersburg for spring training in 1961, he was full of confidence, but to the Yankee brass, little more than a minor league roster filler. Pitching coach Johnny Sain took an interest in him, though, and one day pulled him aside. "You've got four good pitches," he told Jim, "but none of them were outstanding. If he wanted to make it to New York, he'd need to drop his lesser pitches and concentrate on his big three, fastball, curve, and changeup. Drop the knuckleball, at least for now," Sain advised. "Even more, focus on your number one, either the curve or the fastball, and work on that until you've mastered it. Once you've got a pitch you know you can throw in a tight spot, you can start to see yourself in Yankee pinstripes," he counseled. Bouton did Sain one better, dropping the change as well and working almost exclusively with his fastball and curve. The Yankees assigned him to Double-A Amarillo that year, and once again he dominated. He finished second on the club in wins with 13 and led it in strikeouts. His games weren't always pretty, as sometimes his fastballs and curves missed their mark by a wide margin, but as the season wore on, he gained more control as well as more confidence in them. He spent the season once again with Lintz, and this year they were joined by Joe Pepitone. Together they formed an irreverent trio, emerging as the stars and perhaps the future of the Yankees, at least in their eyes. Occasionally, Jim would check out the big club to see how the pitchers were faring. Chip Hilton would have been pleased with what was being reported in the papers. The Yankees were running away with the American League, AL, once again. But Jim now knew firsthand that Chip Hilton existed only in storybooks. Sure, the Yankees were his organization, but it wasn't all for one and one for all in Amarillo. Nor had it been in Greensboro, Auburn, or Kearney. As all the minor leaguers understood, success in New York meant fewer available roster spots on the big club the following spring, and that was bad news for all of them. Closer to home, the definition of individual success from an organizational perspective was largely relative. How well did you do compared to your fellow pitchers? Were you better than the guy lockering next to you?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.